talk to us about not only our overall theme of gender equality, but purpose-driven efforts in that arena. So it's my pleasure to welcome Dana Anderson here. Dana is, I think everybody knows, is the CMO of Mondelez by day, and one of the most extraordinary stand-up comedians by night. The best. Janet Balis, who is head of strategy consulting practice for media and entertainment at EY. And Sophie Galvani, who's the global brand vice president for Dove at Unilever. Winner yesterday of the Cannes Glass Ceiling Award. Very good. And Marta Martinez, who's a senior vice president of advertising sales at AOL. And Michelle Denogean, who is the CMO of Impact. And I do not want to forget to thank Impact enormously. Michelle and also John McNeil, who were instrumental in helping us put together this panel. So thank you very much. So we're going to talk today, as we said, about creating purpose, purpose-driven culture and cultures around equality. But I think let's start out by talking about purpose in driving real change, not purpose for the sake of purpose. And so let's talk a little bit about that philosophy and how it has changed brands' connection with their consumers. And it's jump ball, anybody, anytime. You are so
I actually brought a little show and tell. I'll hold it up. It's really easy. We realized that we really needed our folks to understand what their brand's purpose was and to give voice to it. But we work in a global organization, which is humbling, and language, all strategy is based on language, is very challenging. If I have an Oreo, for example, wonder-filled campaign, there isn't a word in China that means wonder. So we're like, dang. And I was really kind of disappointed. As a lady who worked with me said, I was so mad I blew my casket. They said, you did, and your casket along with it. So we created something we called the luggage tag. I'm just going to show you what it looks like. It's nothing but a ladder laying on its side, but it has one sentence, and four pictures. This is your product, what it means, what it do, and your purpose. And you can't forget the purpose because that's the end of the sentence. And the luggage tag means if your brand's going around on the little luggage thing at the airport and you pick it up and look at this, I should know everything you're doing. And then you go, we're talking about circle number three. And it's not meant to be overly simplistic. It's meant to be, do you have all your parts and pieces? And don't forget the last part. Because brand purpose is, oh, I didn't show you guys, so sorry. Brand purpose is really, really important. Just like this important to you as a person, as a company.
Yeah, I would just share, we think about brand purpose so much in a B2C context. In a B2B context, it's incredibly valuable as well. So it really gives people a sense of the why and connects from your mission with your customers to your employees and everyone in between. So I'm a recent addition to EY, joined about a year ago, John Grisky, Congressman of Colorado, leads our brand marketing communications and our entire go-to-market strategy. What's remarkable is we use the line of a better working world.
Better working Mike. So for us, a better working world is not a tagline. It's not simply, and I'm back off again. A better working world is not just something that you're going to see, which you actually would have seen coming into the airport here in Nice as your luggage was going, because it is an ad, but it's also fundamentally how we approach the world. We have to think as an ecosystem. We have to think about literally creating a better working world in any industry that we serve. And so for me, it was a huge part of why I joined the firm. And in fact, it translates for us, our luggage tag is, the better the question, the better the answer, the better the world works. Because at this moment in time, no one has all the answers. We have to have the humility to ask better questions and to collaborate and connect with people who are really committed to changing the outcome of industries.
I'll add something too.
Michelle, do us a favor, level set a minute. Just tell us a little bit about what Impact is.
Sure. Sure. So I'll pause my answer to that question. So Impact is a technology platform that is here to activate people's purpose. And what we do is we connect brands with their customers, and we crowdsource the ability for the brands to give their customers the power to choose. So if you have a purpose that's tied to a cause, we are enabling all of the customers to choose which cause they want you to direct your funds to. So that's what our platform does. It's around sharing purpose. So that'll probably give context, I guess, to some of my answers too. So one of the things I was going to say as it relates to purpose is I think it's really what the customers demand now, right? You look at customers today, you know, I know when I was growing up, it ages me maybe to this crowd a little bit, it was about the brand that was on your jean pocket. Yeah. But now people choose brands because of shared values. And, you know, do you as a brand stand for what I believe in? And I think that that's powerful, and it's more powerful even so in the younger generation. It's just going to become more and more. So I think the engagement one-to-one with customers about what they care about is really what purpose in engagement is all about.
Okay, so I can speak from a Unilever point of view, because I think probably many of you know that brands with purpose is extremely important to Unilever as an organization. And I have the pleasure of running one of the leading brands in Unilever for this, which is Dove. Since 1957, so nearly 60 years now, Dove's been championing real beauty and releasing your own personal potential for beauty. And actually, Dove's been now really walking that talk, because for the last 10 years, we've had a Dove self-esteem program that has been running really to educate and to talk to young girls about self-esteem and body confidence. We've now hit 19 million young girls in the last 10 years with academically accredited programs. And we know for a fact that this not only is this obviously important society in a kind of societal way, because we know that because of body confidence, girls will opt out of various things like social engagements, or they will opt out even of things like medical appointments, etc., because of their body confidence. So we know it's extremely important, but it also drives business. And just as you were just saying there, I think also for the millennials coming up now, this is extremely important. We have evidence that programs like this are driving purchase intent, they're driving brand equity. We have all the data now to know that that's correlated with awareness of these programs. So it's extremely important, not only from a societal point of view and for girls and women, but also for a business point of view as well.
Sophie, remind us, so Dove's Real Beauty campaign started when?
So the Real Beauty campaign started 1957, which was targeted to women. And then for the last 10 years, we've done the program with girls, because we know for a fact, and we've just done a big global study again on this, that body confidence drops dramatically around the ages of around 17 to 20. There's a massive fall off a cliff. So we've been working very closely with girls to try and alleviate that kind of cliff fall, I would say.
Yeah, Martin, and
you work with a lot of brands, so we get
the privilege at AOL to work with, you know, all of your brands. And what is becoming clear now in purpose is that we've gone from an era where purpose was what the purpose department does and what we do as the ethos of the company, it to be very central to what the brand stands for, because that's how consumers are demanding that we interact with them. So we are really seeing, and I want to almost make an extra point, like, and it is working. It works for the brands, it drives results, and it drives because that's what consumers are demanding of brands. You've got to mean something, you've got to solve some other challenge rather than, you know, that is associated to the product that you're bringing to the market. So at the core of it is also marketing effectiveness, right? So it's phenomenal when you can drive change and when you can respond to consumer needs, but you can do it also from, you know, from driving the business.
Yeah, I think that's actually huge, because when you can tie it together, you can drive more change, right? So tying purpose to purchase in some kind of activity enables so much more as a brand.
I was just going to say, Dana, has Mondelez been measuring it?
I think the Honey Made example for us, a little tiny brand, a little graham cracker, what are you going to say, have a snack? And to get to the whole conversation about what is love and who gets to be in love, everybody's the answer. And how are you going to celebrate that, and how are you going to be with that? provided, I think, for Droga such creative inspiration because it was so much bigger about have a little, you know, how's your lunch? Let's have a little peanut butter. But in fact, to say, we care about something bigger and we're going to stand up for it. They have a little bitty, tiny budget, and they made such impact. And they would come back with the next idea and the next idea, and they were so delicious, you'd go, well, I'll find the money somehow. So I say your creative agencies, your media agencies want purpose-driven strategies because it elevates the whole game.
And you obviously, being Mondelez, you are measuring the impact and the outcomes of these kinds of efforts.
Yeah, and I would go one step. Yes. I would go one step further, right, from the publisher perspective. So we own brands like the Huffington Post or TechCrunch or Engadget. It is at the core of what the editorial business is driving, right? Like we talk about these days about this Lib Revolution and how important it is, and Thrive and all of the programs behind that. So it is so consistent with what consumers are telling us they want to hear about, that we're finally bringing all of those trends together. So if you bring the marketing ecosystem with the publishing ecosystem and all of the other pieces, we really can drive change and, you know, and make the economic machine work. And that's phenomenal when we can do them all together.
And look, I think it's really important, and we just talked about the credibility there, but I think it's extremely important that these programs are kind of credible programs. So we've got academically accredited studies to show how this is actually impacting girls, and the fact that it is actually working. We've got scientifically published data now to prove this, because I think moving forwards, I think the worst thing is if we do this in a light-hearted way and then it becomes something that all brands will jump on as a kind of bandwagon, and then you lose the credibility. So I think it's very important, the rigor behind this, and the fact that we've got external agencies and external consultants. So we just had a big audit by PwC recently to ensure that these actually are accredited programs.
Well, because I do think in years past we undertook a number of efforts because they were the right thing to do. They were the nice thing to do. The reality is we're all in business. We're in commercial enterprise, and we have a responsibility to those consumers and ultimately to the shareholders of these companies. And so I think there's no mistaking that these are more than just love. They have to have real meaning to the consumer and ultimately to the shareholders, and therefore need to be measurable. And I think thanks to technology, we are now able to measure that to a greater degree. So what I want to talk about now, just sort of moving a little bit, gender equality for many brands has kind of been put at the center of purpose, sort of winding them together. But what I would love to know from you is, have we made real differences there? Have we measured our ability to create change when gender equality is at the center of purpose? Are we really, really making a difference for tomorrow's female leaders? What are we doing, and how have we measured that?
No, so we work with the Center for Appearance Research on Dove. We have published papers now which have proven success for girls. I mean, clearly it's very difficult to measure what happens in 20 years to a girl that's been through this program, but for sure we can see the immediate effects that this has and the fact that the body confidence then goes up. And I think given that the link between body confidence and self-esteem and just economic and female empowerment is immense, and I think we're trying as Dove not only to do something about it, but also to elevate the issue and to say it's not a trivial thing. It's something that actually is extremely important when you see that, I don't know, 7 out of 10 girls are saying that they're pulling out of various events because of low body confidence.
Well, you know, one of the themes of the Girls Lounge that we believe in deeply is that confidence is beautiful, and so your company has done so many things to further that truism. But when gender equality is at the center, what else are we seeing?
I think we're at the beginning of the journey, frankly. I think I think the fact that we've achieved consciousness and that it is such a prevalent topic at so many companies and does sit at how we're articulating our sense of purpose is an achievement. And I think we're we've admired the problem. I think at this point we have to shift to action.
Well put.
And so, you know, there's no shortage of data to express that we have gender parity issues from a compensation, from a representation in the boardroom, from a representation in the C-suite. I think we really have to fundamentally tie this to all the elements of how we drive corporate culture, because we know that women, diversity and inclusion, even more broadly than women, is fundamental to shareholder growth. It's fundamental to job creation. And frankly, given the level of disruption that's happening in every industry, you need the characteristics that are inherently female at the helm. And so, you know, we believe, you know, across, for example, Advertising Women of New York, where Marta and I have the privilege of being on the board, we're thinking about this issue, which is not just how do you get women at the top, but we've got to create the path to the top. We have to look at the positions of influence in organizations, and not just influence, again, from a hierarchical leadership standpoint, but who shapes the culture? Who makes it possible for people to thrive, to use the AOL word and the Ariana word? How do you help people thrive in their organizations? And to me, that's so much more of a shift. And use the word rigor. I mean, to me, it's about rigor and commitment and driving it. And I think the journey's only just begun.
Well, you know, what's interesting about that, Janet, is, you know, I feel like there are no excuses anymore. The data is there. There's more data to support the reality of what women mean in the boardroom and from an operating standpoint. It's undeniable. You cannot escape anymore. It is so easy to track. Dana, at Mondelez, in terms of purpose and gender equality, how do you tie that together?
I turned the mic on first, which I'm sure everybody in the back row will appreciate, and thank you for the help. I work in a company run by a woman, and so that has an impact. Where we're trying to make, again, it's a global company working on a lot of emerging and developing markets. This isn't as sexy, but I think it's kind of important. We have a Cadbury chocolate plant in India that is 50% of the people in there are women. And in that country, that is a big movement. I mean, that's a big thing to do. We also have committed $40 million a year for 10 years to cocoa farmer families, of which women are a big part of that, because cocoa farmers are little small farms. It's not like a big industrial thing. And so they need help, support, they need education, they need an understanding about how to preserve their land and who to sell their cocoa to. And so that, for that company to spend $400 million over 10 years to support women at that level is just, it's a different context, but it's kind of understanding it along the whole supply chain, if you will.
But so very, very tangible.
Yes. You know, making real difference in their lives every day in their community.
Well, I think, you know, somebody mentioned it before, but the millennials, they are so purposeful and so thoughtful in so many ways about almost everyday products, if you will. They research the sustainability policies of these companies, the financial commitments they make in areas like that. And so what I love about that, it hurts. That's almost $500 million. So I like that it hurts a little bit. I like that it's very tangible, and it is not soft is fine, but I love that it's tangible, measurable, and it's sort of money where your mouth is.
I think action is what you're talking about. How are you taking action to do this? And you're inviting, you know, your entire ecosystem to get involved, which is amazing. And I think that's where we can really make a difference, is how do we invite participation throughout the entire ecosystem, from our employees to our vendors to our customers, right? Because if we're going to drive change, it's about not just getting the word out, but everybody participating in that.
Yeah. And Sophie, you were talking before about it has to be genuine, right? I think this talks to the authenticity that all of these programs need to have. So it's phenomenal to see how your brands speak about this topic and stand for this purpose in front of consumers, but also how that trickles down to how you run the company and what happens in the people policies and in the decisions that you make in manufacturing. And that's where the authenticity comes from. This is just not, you know, a marketing strategy. It is deeper. It is a purpose, a philosophy of how you drive the company forward.
No, look, I fully agree. And I think with Unilever, we've got a big USLP program that a lot of people know about sustainable living. And gender equality is a massive part of that. And we were just talking there about the supply chain. I think it runs from everything from the head office, getting more women up the organization, all the way through to supply chain. Paul Polman, our CEO, is a he for she impact champion. So he's really, really very vocal about this. And I think it's something that it really everything that we do, we look at advertising, we look at who we employ up the organization, we look at how we treat women in our supply chain and through the whole supply chain. And I think it's just really important. And Unilever has many initiatives to do
this. I think it's another critical issue. Sorry for all the buzzwords, but the authenticity. You know, how ironic would it be if organizations are contributing financially and in other ways to gender equality outside their own companies? So I think, like many things, it all begins at home. Marta, you work with many brands, and AOL is many brands. You have a CEO in Tim Armstrong who is known to be especially supportive of women. Can you talk a little bit about AOL internally and what gender equality looks like in AOL's continued growth path?
Yeah, so Tim Armstrong has that management team that is 50-50 men, women. And starting there, that's pretty unique. One of them is right there in the back of the room, Ali. And so I think that trickles back into the entire organization. Like, we try to very seriously walk the walk as we talk the talk. But then it also reflects on the type of content we create. So one of the biggest commitments of the company is around Makers, which is the largest collection of women's stories. You know, the women that have actually enabled, because you can't be what you can see. So we made it our purpose to tell all of these stories so all of the women in the world could see the examples of the women that did it first, right? And then it trickles down into the philosophy that goes behind Huffington Post and what we think it's important there, how we define success, and what is a third metric of success, very different than just the power and the money that had been driven a more masculine first culture. So it is percolating through the entire what we do, what we publish, how we hire, how we put the teams together, and I think how we run them as well, right? One of the things we started talking about purpose, and one of the things that we do with our teams is we have them write their purpose every year. So each one of our folks in our team writes their vision statement for the year.
Is that teams throughout the
That's a lot of the teams, so. You know, certainly the advertising side of the house, it's becoming now the norm. But it's a really a phenomenal exercise when you help people imagine what they could be and what the possibilities are a year ahead. And you help them drive their career, their year, their contributions through that. And we always do it in a 360 way, which means we're not thinking about each one of our team members as a contributor to the business. We're thinking also about their life and how do they apply the same rigor and discipline that they apply to their business to their personal life, and what are their, you know, and what are their goals. So we celebrate.
It really becomes very, very personal.
It becomes very personal and very professional both, because you've got to apply the same rule set, right? But then, of course,
and somebody read what you wrote.
Right.
And so, yeah.
That's right.
So, Janet, you also at EY work with many, many different kinds of companies. Are there a couple of standout examples of companies who are really living this life of purpose where it's focused on gender equality?
Well,
I would just share, in our own company, we have the initiative Women Fast Forward, and to the point that's been made here where it has to go at every level, one has to embrace the mission around gender equality in every possible permutation it can take in the organization. So yes, it's mentorship and sponsorship, but for us, it's also taking the platform, for example, that we have with entrepreneurs, with Entrepreneur of the Year, which was just celebrated not too far from here, and making sure that there's a track to, so, you know, to me, what's so striking is like, makers and all the things we're talking about create the inspiration to help you believe that you can achieve. But we have to look at the on-ramps too. So we have to look at the on-ramps to entrepreneurship and how we empower people with the right connections, the right resources, so that they have access to capital and support to really drive their businesses forward, because that's an on-ramp. And then the other on-ramp I would share is at the very early end of the spectrum is education. So, you know, if we look at things that, you know, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation are doing, for example, we have to start looking systemically at what creates that next generation of talent that not only believes but has the skills to thrive in a world that's being disrupted so rapidly and frankly has very different skill sets.
Dana, were you waving at me or just...
No,
were you?
I just thought of something that if that helped us so much and personally to think about. If you've ever read Bill Johnson's book, A Story is a Promise... He's kind of a hermity guy. He's not here, trust me, you won't hear it. Who lives in Portland, and he helps book authors and movie writers construct their stories. And he said there's nothing worse than a writer who understands their plot but not their premise. And if you don't understand the premise, you can never write the book. And from his book, we created a way, it doesn't really matter, it's called Storyteller, and it's how you sit down with a brand and help them. He said there's three things you have to know. What's your dramatic issue? What do you care enough about to write the book? What's the momentum? What's the energy that's going to keep your story going? The energy for Romeo and Juliet is deception. Without the lies, the story can't go on. So you need to know what your energy is. The fulfillment is when the people leave the theater and the play is over, what is it that they're going to remember? And he said on Romeo and Juliet, it's the power of love. If you don't get that about your story, your personal story, or your brand story, you can't write it and you can't make the promise. So if you haven't read the book, go read A Story is a Promise, because it's a great little way to get your hands on plot versus premise.
So any other thoughts about maybe brands outside of your own that, you know, you'd love your company to aspire to or to emulate? You know, we have such brilliant examples here. Are there brands that, companies that we should know about that you particularly admire who are maybe approaching this in maybe a different way?
We did a review of well-being marketers, like around the world, little tiny brands that are there. We put them in 8 buckets. We just looked at everything we did. The most prominent thing they do is they either have a great founder story or they have a great purpose, and everything is connected to their purpose. It's a wonderful example, and we found one brand that filled every one of the 8 buckets, which was Ben & Jerry's. They had a big founder.
Very interesting.
Nice Unilever.
All natural.
That's right. That's another
every
Unilever.
Every bucket. They have a great story. I mean, you don't normally think about them as a well-being brand.
But interestingly,
yes.
When they were born.
Yes.
Remember in Vermont.
They've
and the
got
whole
a
thing.
Purpose.
That
right.
was a long time ago. But
see how long that purpose lasts?
Exactly.
1957. Yes.
Yeah.
Well, so
when
does anybody that's a great place to go look.
Ben and Jerry's started, it had to be at least 25 years ago.
Yeah, it's when pot came really big in the U.S.
I don't remember.
Sure.
So, yeah.
But I think other brands, so yes, so Ben & Jerry's is a lovely example. I mean, it's an example within Unilever, and I think we have a few now. So Dove is obviously the one that's been going for the longest, but we've got Lifebuoy that has been saving lives through hygiene. And we've got brands like Tresemme now that are doing work around female empowerment. So a lot of brands now are within Unilever are finding their purpose. I used to work on a brand called Magnum, so with chocolate as well. So interesting to hear about cocoa farms. And we used to do a lot of work with the Rainforest Alliance around sustainably sourcing our cocoa. So there's a lot of purpose coming through now in a lot of the Unilever brands, and every brand is now finding their purpose and kind of
following. When did you buy Ben and Jerry's? I'm just wondering
if there's a... Ben and Jerry's would have been, so I've been in about 15, 20 years ago, about 15 years ago. I've been in now for 20 years in Unilever. So
because that's very interesting. That's the first brand that certainly I remember that I thought really stood for something outside of, you know, itself, delicious ice cream.
Yeah.
Very, very interesting. Well, you know, we've made some progress, a lot of it measurable. We have a very, very long way to go. We've also seen those stats. So what else around purpose and gender equality? Janet, I love that you said earlier, yes, we've spent a lot of time appreciating these issues. Where do we go from here? What else can we do in order to drive real change, measurable change that we will celebrate? What more? I think we talked a little bit about education. The IPG Women's Breakfast this morning was absolutely wonderful with Dr. Mae Jamieson, extraordinary woman, first African-American female to go off in space, and she gave a wonderful talk, and there was a woman who is one of the first, I think, vice presidents, again, at Unilever in Brazil, and she talked about arriving in her office only to find that there was not one ladies' room in the entire building because there weren't any women in management, and one of her first acts was to build a bathroom. And upon completion, the men in the office put her name on the door. Clearly, they didn't expect any other women to come in. It was a great story. And then we heard from Gwyneth Paltrow also about some of the challenges that she's had sort of dealing with the negativity in the press. And so lots of inspirational examples. And there were lots and lots of young women in the room from different training programs and programs that support women. But I think, you know, when you were talking before about women's body image and the loss of confidence around age 17 or so, we've certainly seen enough data on even younger women being very concerned about their ability to carry on in math and science, and so we have various STEM initiatives. Where else are we? What do we need to do to continue to drive change that we can see?
Mm-hmm. So certainly from a Dove point of view, we're now carrying on with our program, so we're going to hit another 20 million women in the next 6 years. We're also working very hard in lobbying, so we work with the World Association of Girl Guides and Girl Scouts, and together we go and lobby at the UN. So it's about getting this this message high up on the agenda and to talk about just how important this is. So going and speaking at conferences and UN platforms to go and get this on the agenda. So we're doing a lot of work like that as well, so not just within the brand, but also on a bigger level to get the purpose out there.
Yeah. I like what Marta said before about purpose. It's not the purpose department. I think on the gender issue, it's not the gender department either. I think we have to fundamentally embrace every person in this room has influence. And so the question is, what can you specifically, personally commit to? It's like, I won't get political, but, you know, when Bill Clinton runs... I'm not going there. But, you know, when he gathers people, and if you look at the billionaires, you know, a commitment to charity, they all leave with a commitment. So I think the number one thing we could do is all embrace the influence and power that we have in this room and say, how can we embrace, for example, a female entrepreneur? If you look at the companies that are changing our world, whether it's Uber, Airbnb, mm-hmm. there's power in disruption. There's power in entrepreneurialism. How do we take those entrepreneurs and make sure that more of the females with brilliant ideas that really understand consumer behavior
are empowered and supported to really thrive and achieve their ambition. That's how we change culture, because incrementalism will be the death of us all. And so we have to really embrace people who have the ideas and the creativity to create new models, because new models will create the change we're talking about.
So one of the things that we are doing in that direction is we created an investment fund called Build by Girls that's run by Suzanne Line, where we're investing in companies that are being created by women, not for women, but by women, right? Which brings all of these threads, and which hopefully will start to get more women into the very comfortable into the entrepreneurship area, because there is a massive bias in that specific area, and that's where it all starts, right? So that's one of the areas, but I would argue a lot of the work we've all done is on raising awareness about the true unconscious bias that exists. It's part of how we have grown as a society. And I would argue that we still have a lot more to do in the raising awareness. We're not done. I know, and I hear us say, yeah, we have to go from talking about the problem to solving the problem. Clearly, there is a lot that we can do in the action side. But the awareness, the truth is, you know, for everybody who has a little girl at home, you can see, they become what they see, right? So you can be what you can see. So I'm excited about the program that the National Association of Advertisers is doing together with the White House, the Girls Lunch, and I think it's the Alliance of Family Entertainment, where they are creating a new code for content creators, for anybody that's creating content, to portray the right model, so that what the kids see growing up on television and the movies, or of course, you know, through any of the devices that we all use to watch, you know, to see content now, portrays the models of what they can become. And that has such an impact in the new generations.
Well, you know, I think such an impact. Talking before about the makers, the women who built America, the genesis of that was Gloria Steinem about 15 years ago now, realizing one day that there were no video histories of women. I mean, occasionally you'd see something on, you know, a Billie Jean or a Gloria, a Bella Abzug, but by and large, absolutely no video history of the great women who made this country. And I think that Makers has made an extraordinary contribution to awareness. And I know that Nancy Armstrong is particularly interested in pushing that down, bringing it to high school girls who want to grow up to be a maker. So I agree with you. Yeah. as much as action in the final analysis is necessary, we can't give up helping people understand this issue. I mean, look in our own industry. You know what happened at JWT. You know, a couple of months ago. You know, some people were surprised, and you know, shame on them. Any of us has been around for a long time. That was no surprise. But here we are in 2016. The awareness is absolutely part of the action for sure. So Michelle, what have you seen on that front?
Well, I was actually, you were talking about children earlier, and I was going to tell a story because I thought it was so interesting. But so Impact at Cannes is doing an activation around gender equality. Just a quick plug on that. It's the Glass Lion is put up all of the award money that they got from the Glass Lion to charity. And so our platform is actually enabling every delegate to choose which charity that money goes to. But I was getting ready to come here a couple weeks ago, and we made these bracelets that say, I support gender equality. It was just, you know, to hand out to everybody. And my six-year-old daughter saw it, and she's starting to learn to read, so she was very curious, and she's struggling. Jen, what, Mommy, what is that? Well, first, what does it say? She's six. And then what does that mean? So it really, really starts there, you know? And it starts with making sure the awareness is there, making sure we're role models. I think that's the biggest thing, because I've been in technology most of my career, and in that space, it's not as prevalent as other spaces to have a woman in leadership. And I realized very early on in my career that it wasn't just about me, but it was about everybody at the company, you know, and making sure that I was that role model for them. So
I think one of the greatest things certainly that's happened for all of us in the last couple of years is what Shelley
has built and continues 24/7 to build here at the Girls Lounge. And if anybody can create awareness, it is Shelly Zales. So, Shelly, you want to chat with us a little bit about some of the new things that are going on with the Girls Lounge?
Because it is about purpose, and we say when purpose meets passion, you're unstoppable. We're unstoppable, and we're unstoppable when we do it together. Alone, we're powerful. Together, we're unstoppable, and that's where impact happens. And I just want to bring up purpose. Purpose is a really important word, and when you realize how important the word is, you'll actually start understanding why action matters, not that it's a nice to have, but a need to have on so many levels. Number one. Millennials. Millennials are not the next generation, they are the now generation, and more importantly, they're the purpose generation. Millennials have purpose in their DNA, period. Think about the implications. That means they are our future leaders. They only want to work for companies that care about the world and making the world a better place. So if you don't do it to make your business better, do it if you want to attract and retain the talent and the best talent in the future. That's a really important thing to understand, and why in the Girls Lounge we also connect today and tomorrow's future leaders, which we work with all of us women here, because we want to push that forward, and that's really important, and it drives everything that we do. And visibility. There are four things that matter in the Girls Lounge that create this sisterhood of some sort. One is visibility. If you can see her, you can be her. If you can't see her, where's your aspiration? Where's your inspiration? Where's your positive role model? And that is why these conversations are so important. Visibility. The second is that you have a signature moment as a company. Companies don't make shit happen. People do. Our people happen to be women. CEOs, CCOs, CIOs, CTOs, CROs, project managers. It doesn't matter. We all contribute in significant ways, and that's really important for us. The third, obviously, financial. We're an industry collaboration. It is not my lounge. It is not yours. This is ours, and it's why programming in here, or conversations, I hate the word panel or programming, is done by any woman in the Girls Lounge. Wenda picks up the mic. All the women show up. It's not mine. This is ours. This is our space to make a difference. Together. It is creating an environment for all of us to come together and share in this journey, because that's how change will happen. It will not happen if I raise my hand and say, oh, let's get impact happens when the collective kicks it up. And I think that that's really important. And the fourth is really the personal passion. Change won't happen if you don't care. We can all talk about all the things that need to happen, but when you walk the fucking talk, change happens. Care. Companies are buildings, they're institutions. People make change happen. And I think those are really important. And so this ANA and AFE initiative that we're doing with the Girls Lounge came out of the Girls Lounge. We went all to Washington to start, talking about things that matter to us, and thought, well, we talk about see her, be her. Well, why don't we create an equality metrics? Because if we can't dimensionalize it and we can't create accountability around it, then, everyone will be able to say, I'm doing that. Because there's no one testing you. There's no one, including yourself, having to track it, right? So if you can't measure it, you can't create accountability. So in copy testing, we have scores, persuasion, purchase interest, likability we added several years ago because of the virality of the world, and now we're adding equality. And we're adding equality to range from visibility. Is she, in the spot? Is she in the media? How many speaking parts? Does she have credibility? Is she presented as a professional, just like men are professionals, or just, through the spectrum, all the way through objectification? And we're fortunate today to have Madonna Badger here, who has been doing so much work on the objectification, women not objects, and how do we really create that positive role model? And I want to add one more really important thing, which is it's not just for our daughters. It's also for our sons. It's for everyone. Look at what we talk about with sexual assault on college campuses. Where do you think that comes from? When the boys see girls giving blowjobs to hamburgers, how do you think boys think about girls? That they're objects. And so it starts with the conscious. Be conscious of your unconscious and start thinking about these things for all of us, not just for our girls. but for our world today and how we are portraying each and every one of us. And how do we want to be portrayed? How do we want people to see us? What kind of role models do we put in there? Because what we have in media is the inspiration, the aspiration. And when you see things that you can't achieve, like skinny girls, that's where all the anorexia and bulimia comes from. And when you see the sexualization and objectification of women, that's why we're encouraging, you know, this behavior. It's not just happening. Shame on us. And why should we leave this legacy for this next generation to inherit? Let's fix our shit. Let them create their own new problems. But this should be our responsibility in our lifetime to say, I can make a difference. And if you can make a difference, don't sit around and say, yep, it's a problem. Yep, it's a problem. Well, who's going to fix it if it's not you and if it's not me and if it's not us collectively? And I think that's what this is all about.
Well, sad.
Oh.